welcome to ET Markets ET webinar here. And my name is Shruti Zanil.
Thanks.
First, let's start with the black money.
Yeah.
Sleepless nights for investors, for people.
That's right.
For taking out money from the ATM.
Yes.
Opposition is, you know, going all crazy. Yes, with everything they have.
Mm.
So, what investors want to understand is that, fine, they're going to be, the long-term story of demonetization is positive.
Mm.
But in the short term, it has taken a toll on markets.
That's right.
And, you know, so if I look back recent data, it says that almost 10 lakh crore of investors' wealth has already been wiped out from BSE. So, yes, it could be a knee-jerk reaction,
mm.
but what, how do you want to, how do you say that you want to carve investor nerve, calm investor nerves as to what is in store for the near term as well as for the long term? Because suddenly there's a shift in strategy. You know, earlier analysts used to say that consumption is going to be the next big theme for at least 2016, 2017, but given the scenario, it might change.
So thanks, Hitesh. So what I'd like to do from an investor perspective is to start off with this whole demonetization initiative, right, and put it in proper perspective to the investors. Now, the clearly stated objective was that this is something which is targeted at bringing out the hordes of back money which the country had accumulated over a 50-60 year time frame,
mm-hmm.
and that it was meant to target counterfeiting from across the border for terror financing,
mm-hmm.
counterfeiting from within the country for Naxal and Maoist financing,
that's right.
as well as the black money which was stocked up in lockers and the rest, right? But the decision which was taken to attack black money, right? Now, government, as you know, black money has four components to it, right? People who take away money without paying taxes, that's black money.
Right.
There's four places where it can go and stay. Right, there's the gold, there's real estate, there's foreign banks, Swiss bank accounts, and other foreign tax havens, and there's Indian rupee cash. Right, so while this is targeted at black money, this is only one of the four places where black money is. So, first of all, this is not saying that the whole black money is going to go out of the system,
absolutely.
This is only the cash black money which is going to go out of the system. That's one. Second, you got to remember is that this demonetization is attacking the cash money.
Mm.
So I think the first thing we need to understand that what will be the intentions of the government, the implementation of the action is on the cash money market.
Right.
If they understand this. Why I want to say this is, people should not mistake that all the black money is being targeted.
Yes.
Fine. Right? At the same time, they should remember that all the cash money is not black money.
Right.
Right? So what's being targeted is the cash money market.
Right.
Of which black money is a component.
Black money.
Right. Okay. So having understood that black money and cash money are different,
right.
and it's like a Venn diagram where the overlap of black money and cash money is what the government is targeting.
That's right.
Right. Now, when you look at it from that perspective, so understand the intention of the government is only to target the black money in cash.
Black money in cash.
Absolutely. So the demonetization effort by taking out 86% of the notes in circulation.
That's right.
Right. Has an unintended side effect that is hurting the cash economy.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
So, if you just think about what the government wants to do, government doesn't want to hurt the cash economy. Now, the ideal situation from a long-term perspective, government, yes, definitely wants to move the cash economy to a more plastic economy, to
That's
a more online economy.
Right.
But these are long-term nice to have, not something which needed a dramatic and drastic action to get it done.
That's right.
Right? Once you understand this perspective, you'll realize that government will re-monetize the cash economy as soon as it's practically feasible. So first thing that people need to understand is that this shortage of cash is not going to last forever.
That's right. That's
right? So the cash is going to come back. So please, those who are thinking that Mr. Modi is against the cash and he's sucked out this, no, he's only sucked out the old notes. He is going to replenish with new notes. And he wanted to change the design of the notes, the compact notes, because for the precise reason that the old notes need to cease to exist.
That's right.
So 86% of this money which has gone out of circulation, definitely one more thing to remember. All of this 86% is not going to come back. When I'm saying he's remonetizing, he's not going to again put it. Why? Because what is the real cash money the economy needs? Every economy needs cash to thrive. That's India, as a still a developing country with a more agrarian economy, needs more cash than other developed countries to thrive. That level of cash will be reintroduced into the system. Now, whether that is 30%, 40% of this 86%,
right,
is a decision the government will take. But definitely the full 86 will not come back because the country doesn't need that much of money rotating. The only reason that money was in circulation was because a lot of it was locked up. So once money is rotating freely, so the government will reintroduce, even the 1,000 rupee note will be reintroduced in a short while. So when you look at it now, when you look at, you mentioned consumption as getting hit, right?
Yes.
The consumption is getting hit because the cash of money got hurt. When it gets reinflated, consumption is going to come back. So first thing I want to calm people's minds is that this cash hasn't disappeared for, you know, ever. Cash is going to come back through legitimate channels, through the bank accounts, through, and the future cash which comes back will be tracked, numbered, monitored, so that fresh black money creation is minimized. Now we can never say that fresh black money will not be created, but it's minimized. And second, it has set a fear factor into the corrupt people in the bureaucracy and everywhere, because he knows if he takes it more, next time the government may again ban 2,000 rupee notes. So one thing it has achieved is it has put a scare through the black money economy, but the cash money will come back. Yes, the government probably did not foresee the amount of cash that people will desperately need, because it was festival season. It is also farming, sowing and sowing season for the farmers. So they probably underestimated the immediate needs for cash from genuine taxpayer people. So that's where, in managing that, the government probably is a little bit on the back foot, that the opposition has got a chance to attack them, and they are not defending it. Whereas when Mr. Modi made the announcement, and if he had come clean with a lot of the difficulty, he did mention that 50 days clear of Merco time, but that was more it was over a superficial level. If only the government had gone down, drilled and said this, and all this news was new. They are now reacting to it. So that is my only little bit of a concern on the way this has been managed. But apart from that,
I will come back on one point that you said, that government is targeting cash money,
cash market is simultaneously as a side effect getting hit.
And the other forms of black money which is getting stacked is in other areas such as real estate gold. Arun Jaitley just mentioned that
down, drilled and said this, and all this news was new. They are now reacting to it. So that is my only little bit of a concern on the way this has been managed. But apart from that,
I will come back on one point that you said, that government is targeting cash money,
cash market is simultaneously as a side effect getting hit.
And the other forms of black money which is getting stacked is in other areas such as real estate gold. Arun Jaitley just mentioned that this is just the beginning. So do we are we going to see much more stricter norms with respect to real estate, with respect to gold, with respect to other asset classes, which could be targeted next after this move by the government?
I think no doubt about it. Mr. Modi himself has gone to saying that ye aakhri kadam nahi hai. So yes, in what form and how the government acts. You see, I think if you look at it from a slightly distanced perspective and look at the actions of the government over the last 6 months, so right from Jandan Yojana, where he was making people to put more money in bank accounts,
to
direct benefit transfers or subsidy, where the government's generation of black money or cash money was cut down. Otherwise, government itself through the Narega scheme was the biggest cash supplier to the economy. So that, and a part of that is going black. The leakages through the system. So that has been cleaned up. Third, the Mauritius, the taxation treaty. So that is another hit. Second is the letter to all the Swiss banks saying, please give me your thing. Then the amnesty scheme for those who that. So you see all of these steps, they are overall leading to this, that I'm giving you a last chance to do this. I'm giving you a last chance to do that. This is the way I'm headed. The only thing is, nobody anticipated that he would act so fast and so quickly, because the speed of attack, whether it's a surgical strike or this, is in the surprise and in the speed. So on the other three, on the foreign bank money, I think
they're already acting.
So there's nothing new needed there. They're already going after, because both the Mauritius accounts and the Swiss accounts, they are acting through their various channels. The gold part and the real estate part, So one of the positive side effects. I don't know, all investors will be happy with this or not.
Right.
But the real estate market is definitely going to correct.
Correct.
And so person who had stashed away his black money, let's say he had bought a house for properties, 20 crores.
That's
right. If that house value is today 15 crores,
okay,
you automatically wiped out a part of his black money.
That's right.
Right? So as an incidental, this may not be intended, but as an incidental side effect, that man's accumulation of that in black money has now come down because of the valuation impact.
Definitely, definitely.
That's one thing. Gold.
Would want to put a percentage on that?
I think these numbers keep getting bandied about, and we have no logical basis or a data base in our country to really judge this.
You know, let's say it could correct by 20%, 30%, or
the real estate market.
The real estate market.
See, I'm not an expert on real estate, so it's unfair to really see, because see, even in the real estate, it's not fair to paint it with one black brush.
Absolutely.
As far as I know, most big real estate developers have been taking quite pure check-based money for a long time.
That's right.
Okay. Right? The black money in the real estate market is more on the old properties being sold and the second-hand exchanges and in land, not in buildings,
not in
agriculture land and those kind of land. So it's very hard to do that. Okay. But I must tell you one point here, where the amount of fresh black money going into real estate will come down.
That's right.
How?
That's right.
The government in the south, we call this a guideline value. I don't know what this is called in other states,
okay,
but it is the rate at which the government says this is the current marketable price of this land.
Okay.
And so when you go to register a property,
is it the circulary that you
this mean? Maybe it's a circulary.
Okay.
I think different states use different terminology.
Right.
So back in Tamil Nadu, we use something called guideline value.
Okay.
So what happens when you go to the register office to register a land,
that's the minimum,
you have to pay tax at the register. So there's no sense in somebody. So that means, so when in Tamil Nadu, what's been happening? Every year the government has been raising guideline value 15%.
Okay.
So in some cases, there's actually that the real values are much lesser than the guideline value.
Okay.
So the real estate is an avenue to park.
Black money
is getting curtailed by the steady increase in the guideline value.
Because
then, you know, there's no point. If you're going to go and register and say, okay, man, 10 crore ka property ke liye main uska tax ke liye bharne wala hoon.
Right.
So then, above that, if the real value is higher, that portion only can be the black.
Absolutely.
So I think real estate is already going through that phase where the black component is coming down.
Right.
So I think, but I would hesitate to put a number on what percentage of black money.
So, and real estate as a sector, I think, saw some boost in prices. I mean, I'm talking about the stock prices.
Mm.
So, they saw some bit of uptick in the past 12 odd months.
Mm.
And but then, I think, can we say that they're all headed for a correction or some sort of, you know, fair value kind of a thing? You could say that?
Well, I would actually argue that 6 months from now, that would be a sector which would do very well.
That would do very well.
And I'll tell you why. Because one, it's getting cleaned up with this.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
As you mentioned.
Yes.
Because of the guideline values and everything.
Okay.
One.
Okay.
Second, this is going to natural correction in these property prices.
That's right.
So we are going to see a correction in the actual real estate values.
Absolutely.
At the same time, what demonetization is going to do is make banks flush with money.
That's right.
Because, as you said, consumption is going to come down.
Right.
Inflation is going to come down.
Right.
Then rate cuts are going to happen.
So
lending rates are going to come down because banks sitting with surplus, how much more will they invest in government bills?
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
So, so there will be an inflection point in a few months from now where the dropping home loan and property loan rates and the dropping prices would actually lead to a reversal in that sector and demand actually pick up.
Okay, perfect.
So that's
a very good scenario that we've painted here for. Especially for investors who are who hold a lot of real estate stocks.
So,
don't worry, guys. I think if you're holding real estate stocks, they're going to bounce back. They might be going through some near-term pain, but that is all temporary, as Mr. Subramaniam said. But they're going to bounce back. Don't worry. Hold it. That's right. Is that the word? Hold it?
Absolutely.
Or do you want, they can start also, looking at buying on tips.
See, okay, there's an interesting perspective as an investor, right? I think the product called REITs will start picking up.
Okay.
Because as the release value is correct and the rental yields go there,
right,
REITs will become very good investment.
Investment option.
So I see when the revival is happening, the REITs will start to pick up.
Okay.
So investors can wait for those kind of opportunities
right.
Because those, because of the rental income which the REITs get, are a much more stable, fairly inflation hedged kind of an investment vehicle, which will really have its, SEBI has actually relaxed those guidelines. They've done a lot of
that's
the REITs, but the market hasn't picked up.
Right.
But with this, the coming phase of what's going to happen, I would see that REITs will probably come up as a very good investment vehicle, and investors can do well to wait, because then that's de-risked real estate. Okay. Because there is the valuation impact, but there is also cash flows cash which keep flows regularly coming in REITs, as opposed to just real estate. And second is that for investors to go and buy real estate stocks, it's still a high-risk phenomenon. Mm-hmm. So if you go through mutual funds, I don't see any mutual fund having a real estate sector fund.
Yeah,
so the real estate exposure comes through what diversified mutual funds pick real estate stocks. So I would recommend to investors to stay away from real estate stocks as an acquisition. They already hold them, it's fine.
Right.
But wait for the REITs, and maybe they look at funds which have real estate, which are taking this call to look at it in those perspectives.
Okay.
Because, you know, understanding a developer, studying him, all of that, you know, it's not a very, because it's still a slightly opaque industry in terms of disclosures, what is happening, you know. So I would recommend that they use the mutual fund route even to acquire real estate, whether through REITs, which can come up, or through those funds which are taking a significant exposure into real estate.
So, investors who are holding real estate stocks, and to keep them, keep holding them. But if you want to expand it, or if you want to invest more, then I think this is a time to just hold back right now and look for mutual fund route to really diversify your portfolio. And REIT is the next upcoming investment opportunity that you can watch out for. So the keyword is that for real estate stocks, it's not over yet. I mean, there's nothing to write off from your portfolio. So if you're holding it, please hold it. There's no need to sell right now. But then again, look for opportunities from the mutual fund perspective, as well as REITs, R-A-I-T-S, right? Now, in the recent, I think in the past 10 days, in fact a week, a lot of brokerage houses have, scaled down their GDP estimates. And can we say it's a knee-jerk reaction, or are they really, they really mean that yes, GDP is going to take a hit and it is for the long term?
You know, I think even the Ministry of Finance has accepted that the GDP growth will come down over the next two quarters.
So we might lose the tag of world's, fastest growing economy.
But I think it's only a quarter GDP.
Quarter
the
GDP.
Annualized GDP should still come in excess of 7%.
Okay.
And at 2017, it will be back to normal growth rates.
Okay.
So this is only for the next two quarters, which is this coming quarter and the next one. Mm-hmm. That you see, you are going to see a GDP contraction because consumption, cash-based consumption, is going to get a hit.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So you can't run away from the fact that short term GDP for the quarters concerned is going to correct. But you got to understand the logic, the reason behind the correction.
Mm-hmm.
There's no fundamental change in the Indian economy's prospects or anything. What's happening is people used to, when you get a harvest, take the money, go buy a tractor, go buy a Honda car, whatever, right? That's now put through the bank, right? Now, how far will you go and withdraw that money, again go and buy in cash, as opposed to writing a check to do it? Now, these are guys who are not used to the banking system. They've got to understand, right now, in a knee jerk, they put the money into the bank. Right, whatever he gets. So it'll take some time for him to come back to the thought of buying the car again. Right?
Okay.
So it is only a postponement of the consumption. That's the point I want to make. It's not a consumption lost forever.
Right. No, I understand. In fact, there's a very interesting point. One of the analysts quoted that, when PM Modi was announcing the demonetization move, did he forget Newton's law of motion?
For every reaction, there's equal and opposite reaction.
You know, so it will take all the more effort to bring back the economy back where it is, probably, before the demonetization. Is it valid?
But tell me one thing, two things I would say here. Political element, economic element.
That's right.
This is an entirely economic decision, not a political decision.
Absolutely.
Okay,
absolutely.
First thing you need to understand.
Yes.
Second, the intensity of the opposition's reaction is itself the clue.
Mm.
The opposition would not worry about something which is not going to hurt their voter base.
Absolutely.
The very fact they see the danger of this, of Modi's this decision, actually snatching their voter base,
one,
and snatching their ability to buy votes through cash,
two, okay,
which is leading to the intensity of this reaction,
right,
and they're picking out the cues and this and making the dramatization.
Uh-huh.
So it's only when you fear your home, when your home is under threat, that your reaction is violent.
Violent.
My case rests there. Right? You look at it. If only they had jumped into the bandwagon and said, this is a good nation of Modi, they are worried about their political futures.
Yes.
So, I'm just saying, you look at it from a perspective of the stronger the reaction from a political opposition, the greater they are worried about
their own.
Themselves. So, that's the political call. And I do believe that this is not a political decision, this is an economic decision.
Right.
Why economic decision? Do people understand the full ramifications of this for the economy?
Right.
Short term consumption getting impacted, two quarters GDP coming down.
That's right.
Real estate prices coming down.
Right.
These are the two negatives of this and the hardship that people face.
Which
is economic. Look at the positives now. First positive. 86% of this money under circulation is all not going to come into the banking system.
Absolutely.
Correct? Why is it not going to come? Because a guy will hesitate to declare something which he cannot justify because there is a 60% taxation. Because there's a 200% penalty on the tax.
That's
applicable. Right. So 40% is the tax bracket. 200% penalty on that, whatever. 60-70%. So he will hesitate to pay that much as tax because he doesn't want to be seen in public. Because there is no amnesty for that now.
That's
what the government promised amnesty, that was over. That where, you know, 30th September, he said, declare it, pay 60% tax, I won't disclose your name.
I won't disclose your name.
This time, he's not saying he won't disclose. So people are worried, because even if that tax is worth it, because even das paisa bachta hai to bachta hai. But so it's not. That's why you see Ganga mein rupay ki note beh rahe hain, Brahmaputra mein beh rahe hain. Right? So, but just think 1 minute.
Yeah.
Suppose out of this 86%, 20% doesn't come back.
Right.
Let's say 66%, which is also very optimistic, my point. But for argument's sake, 20% of this cash doesn't come back into the system.
Right.
What happens, you know? It's straight profit to the government.
It's straight profit.
It is straight a dividend. RBI has the ability. To declare a dividend to the government.
Right.
So it's straight income to the government, with this positive impact on the fiscal deficit.
Okay.
See that. First positive.
Right.
Second positive. Some money is going to come in. Right? That is the genuine non-black white money will come to the system. Right? Because a person who's just keeping it for emergency purposes will now tell it. A housewife who was talking away will now put it back. Right? The Nokrani who gets it, who was doing, will now have a Jandan Yojana account, will come in. Some of it will come back in. Some of it will come in through the other resources. That is, politicians will typically call all the party workers and say, har din, aap jaake 2 lakh, really har din gyakti kar do, main ek saal, 2 saal ke baad le lunga aapse.
That's right.
Right? That's happening in the market. So that's money which will come back into the system.
Right.
Now this flow of money, right? And you just imagine the scale of it, okay? The estimate is that it will be between 8 to 12 lakh crores.
Okay, 8 to 12 lakh
crores. Already SBI has got 1.5 lakh crores. Yes. SBI has 20% share of the banking market.
Right.
So 1.5 into 5 is already 7.5 lakh crores. Effectively, is State Bank market share. But I suspect it won't be 7.5, it will be slightly less because in this, State Bank would get a higher share because they have far more branch network than the rural areas. Okay. So 8 to 12 lakh crores is the actual cash deposits the banking system is going to get. Benchmark this against the individual bank deposits in the country is 50 lakh crore.
That's right.
So what percentage is this of that?
Mm.
It could be 20-25%.
Right.
So you're going to see a 20-25% increase in the bank deposit base.
That's right.
Majority of being in CASA.
Right.
At least for the short term.
Definitely.
So if you look at it, so what is this going to mean now? First, it's going to mean that interest rates, right? Banks, their net interest margin is going to widen.
Right.
They are going to seek to deploy it and not put more and more into government securities.
That's right.
Compounded with this is the consumption impact on inflation, which will help RBI to cut rates.
Absolutely.
So when RBI cuts rates further, banks again have to follow suit. Plus they are flush with liquidity, so no excuse not to cut rates. So both deposit rates and lending rates will come down.
Right.
So this will be big benefit for banks,
right?
One, because they also, their existing holding of treasury bills will go up in valuations. So bank stocks will show higher earnings per share over the coming weeks and quarters, right? And the lending will ultimately get picked up because there'll be a transition point. At what rate will a capex, which is not happening in private sector today.
It was happening.
At what rate will we see, okay, theek hai, abhi itna low hai rate, main kar lunga. So that tipping point
That depends.
Sunlight. So I think that these are the positive things for the economic factors behind this decision.
Right.
And the dropping interest rates, the biggest beneficiary again will be the government of India. Because they are the biggest borrower in the market.
They're the biggest borrower.
Okay. So I think, you know, one has to understand that this is an economic decision and not a political decision.
Perfect. I'll take a cue from that and I'll say that what Modi did was in line to, you know, really bolster the economy, right? So can we say, taking what opposition doing and everything, what is happening, can we say that 2019, Abki Baar Modi Sarkar?
Well, I don't want to comment on a political because people have short memories, whether it's good or bad. Right now, the memory will be bad, tempered by the overall good that I'm contributing to the nation.
That's right.
Then, you know, over a period of time, they'll actually look at kya mera income bar raha hai. So 2009 is too far away.
UP elections?
Again? See, I would hesitate. I'm not a political expert.
Okay.
I'm not a political
analyst. Absolutely.
It's unfair of me to.
Perfect. So, going by, you know, we'll pick up the banking sector and we've discussed it in detail.
Mm-hmm.
But coming back to the very minimal point, which says that few months back, banking was considered to be, let's say, no-go sector, right? Can it emerge? And, you know, data proves that, can it emerge as a dark horse right now? And suddenly, you know, people can look forward to beating down banking stocks, which is already there?
Absolutely. And I have no doubt about it.
Even PSUs, which have heavy net NPA problem?
Absolutely. So here's one thing about the net NPA problem, which I wanted to talk about today. If you look at, there was a sharp spike in the NPS reported last year.
That's right.
Right? But what the broader market doesn't know and what investors don't know, right, is that when mutual funds look at banking stocks, right, they not only look at the disclosed NPA number,
that's right,
they generally add back the restructured loans and advances of that particular bank.
Okay. Right.
Okay? Because there are multiple schemes where the bankers restructure the
that's
loans.
Right. That's
second is the fact that up until the previous year, a bank was allowed to declare something as not NPA, even though other banks had declared it as an NPA.
Right.
Mr. Rajan removed that kavach and said, if any one bank in a consortium of lenders declares it, sabko declare karna. So if you look at most of these other loans had been restructured by the various banks.
Oh.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So if you add back restructured loans to net NPAs, the total NPS as from a mutual fund perspective, we would look at it.
Right.
That number has gone up only marginally.
That's right. Okay.
So if you say year on year, what's happened is that the net NPA reported has shot up,
but
the restructured has dropped.
Okay.
So the net cumulative impact of that is less.
Is less.
One. Second is the fact that, so because of that, right, market goes by two things. YOY and a linear approximation. Let me explain both these things. So if a market says an earnings of a particular bank was at 10 and 8, he'll project 6 because of the linearity of the thought process. Second is YOY, right? So he'll say 8 over 10, right? So there's a 20% drop.
Okay.
So he'll say next also there will be another 20% drop. So these two factors, the moment the drop is not 20% and the moment that the stocks will actually rally because market prices and consensus estimates of stock prices.
Right.
Oh, right. So we are at that point where because of this thing, right? And the third thing about public sector banks and you mentioned, right? Everybody tends to think that all NPA are willful defaulters. It is a fact of matter.
That
there are economic NPAs and there are willful defaulters.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. So the economic NPAs, as the economy gathers in strength, will naturally keep coming back to the banks.
Keep coming back.
And when that comes back, a loan which is written off, you know, it's a written off is a very hot word today
because
of what happened in Parliament, right?
Yes, sir.
When the loan is written off, remember one thing, when money comes back to a normal loan, right, principal which it goes doesn't come to the profit of the bank.
No,
the interest income only comes to the bank. But on a written off loan, principal plus interest goes to the bottom end of the bank.
Okay.
So you are going to see a huge V-shaped recovery in the coming years in bank profitability and the market's expectation of future earnings, which is the P/E ratio.
That's right.
So both the re-rating as well as an actual improvement in profits in the next 12 to 18 months, you're going to see across the banking spectrum. Because not only that, with all these Jan Dhan Yojana and these accounts happening, banks to get into consumer finance. India is still among the most underpenetrated consumer finance in the world.
Right.
We are at the bottom.
We are the one.
Right. So there's a huge scope for banks and even other financial services thing to increase. So I would say banking sector, and one thing, very simple thing, if you look at Bank Nifty, over the years has always outperformed Nifty.
Okay, perfect.
And the final point, 35% of FII holdings in the country are in the banking and financial services.
That's right. No,
so you know something that FII doesn't know. So I would say that
Mr. Subramaniam rest his case saying that Bank Nifty always outperforms Nifty.
That's the past track record.
Right. So that's what history tells us, right? So if in case you, as an investor, have written off banking stocks from your portfolio, this is the time to buy, right? Because they are trading, they've already plunged quite a lot. And if you think, from our side, from Mr. Subramaniam's side, banking stocks are likely to outperform and probably get a V-shaped recovery. So banking is the right bet for you right now. And you can get into all the beaten down stocks right now in the PSU space as well as the private banking space.
Again, to interject, there are enough banking sectoral funds, at least 15 or 20 in the market.
Right.
Including
right.
Sundaram already has a financial services opportunities fund. So I would still recommend to investors to go into these funds rather than buy individual stocks. Because study of individual stocks, which is likely to report a bad quarter and further correction.
Absolutely.
Right? Rather than do that, there are good choice and options. There are 18 to 20 banking and financial sector funds in the market.
Absolutely. So just to bring it down or just to clarify a little bit more, if you don't have the time to really pick stocks, I think going by the mutual fund route is the best option for you. And there are a lot of mutual funds available, banking mutual funds available in the market, which can take care of that problem. So don't worry, banking is still the hot, we could say it's a very hot sector right now, and which will even become even hotter in probably 6 months or 12 months from now. Next section, I think we'll take some questions from our readers which have already come. I think we have some time.
Yeah.
I'll just quickly take care of one question. This is from Pratik Datta.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to know about the rupee, the currency, which has already taken a plunge not because of economic developments that have taken place, but because of global developments as well. And so it could be Trump, it could be Fed raising rates probably next month. And so rupee has come down, but the decline is not as much as probably what we've seen in other emerging markets. So that is something which is a positive takeaway that, okay, fine, we've taken a hit, but then the hit is not that severe as compared to others. So I think it talks about more about the economic fundamentals of our country, RBI and everything. So where exactly you see rupee headed probably in the next 6 months or 12 months, and something that investors should be worried about?
Okay, see, again, not a banking currency expert to actually predict a 6 or 12 month rupee, right. But what I can tell investors is how they can look at the rupee's trends, right? Now, the basic rule behind a rupee is fundamental value. Mm-hmm. Like, currency is just like stocks.
That's right.
There's a fundamental value and there's a technical liquidity value.
Okay.
Right? So you can never predict the technical or liquidity factor, but you can predict fundamentals, like you do cash flow for discounting in our stocks.
That's right.
So like that, in the currency market, there is something called purchasing power parity.
Right.
Right? Which is what? When you compare between two countries, the inflation differential between the two countries, purchasing power difference, will determine the direction of the currency.
Okay.
That is, that country which has higher inflation will weaken. Mm-hmm. By how much? By the difference in inflation.
Okay.
Right? Now you can't swear a CPI or a WPI or base changes.
Right.
So inflation is a hard number to track.
Right.
So what bankers do is they substitute PPP with IRP, interest rate parity.
Okay.
Now, interest rate parity is what? Taking the government's borrowing rate so that you take away default risk out of the picture, right? Because real rate plus inflation is nominal rate of interest, right? So they use the nominal rates of the government of India as a surrogate for inflation.
Okay.
So when you take the difference between the government's borrowings, right, between two countries, that will give you a clue on whether your currency is going to appreciate or depreciate. So everybody says the moment there's depreciation, they panic. As if our country is being depicted in a bad light and the strength of the country is weakening. No. US 10-year rates today are at what, 2% levels?
Yes.
India 10-year rates 7% level. So a 5% depreciation of the rupee year on year is what the fundamental predicts.
Okay. Right.
So if you are at 68, 5% of 68 is automatic should happen.
Yeah.
When the rupee strengthens because FII flows come in.
That's right. Right.
People feel our country is got stronger. No, it is just a liquidity inflow.
Yes.
The real factor is that the currency has to depreciate by the difference. And now, US interest may be rising, Indian interest are coming down.
So
from an FIS perspective, he is investing in a country where the interest rates are falling down,
right.
But his own country's interests are going up.
Going up,
so it's a narrowing trend, which means that the rupee is not going to weaken as much as other emerging market countries.
Mm.
So when an FII puts money, it's into an emerging market basket.
Yeah.
So he will put his money there where the depreciation is going to be less. He knows that every country, the depreciation is going to be there. Right. So from our investors' perspective also, they shouldn't panic at every depreciation because mind you, for making India to become a success,
that's right.
For our export program to be success, we have to remain competitive.
That's
so this rupee not weakening as much as other competing countries is not really that good news because we are competing in which country to export to which country.
That's right.
So some amount of an RBI and the government will, according to me, gently manage a programmed devaluation of the rupee.
Okay.
Right? They don't want shocks. They don't want sudden bursts of
sudden burst. Right.
But there will be a gradual devaluation which will happen over a period of time at between 3 to 5%. Why? Because 5% is today's differential.
That's right.
2 years from now, I see US interest rates at 4 and our interest rates at 6. So it could be 2.
2%, yeah.
So somewhere between 3 to 5% is a good range of depreciation to expect for the rupee over the medium term.
Perfect.
So people shouldn't get panicky. But the way the market is, it never goes in a straight line.
Absolutely.
Jerk. But when it comes back, it won't go back as low as the previous. It'll remain slightly higher.
Yes.
Right? Definitely. So that's the way. So you can see that I would say crossing 70 next year has to happen.
Has to. Perfect. Perfect. I think Mr. Subramaniam laid down the whole rupee equation quite nicely. And so investors or viewers who are watching this program shouldn't worry about rupee declining for at least next 12 months. It is on the right course. So nothing out of the picture is not happening. So it is on the right course. There's another very interesting question from Aditya Reddy. So he says that with Donald Trump in picture, are we heading for a global recession?
Absolutely not. Okay. So for a minute, if you take us a lot of India, assume you're sitting in Papua New Guinea and looking at it, right?
Yeah.
Trump is not very different from Mr. Modi.
Right.
Why am I saying this? His victory was unexpected as much as Mr. Modi's was unexpected.
Right. Absolutely.
He's right wing as much as Modi was perceived to be right wing. He has a business focus, a businessman's approach to an economy.
Right.
And though Mr. Modi is not a businessman himself, everybody agree with me that he thinks like a businessman.
Absolutely.
And acts like a businessman.
He
acts as the CBO of our country when he goes out anywhere else. Right?
True.
So Mr. Modi and Trump are not very different.
Mm.
Okay, one. What's the difference is that Mr. Trump is trying to protect his domestic, whereas Mr. Modi is trying to expand, given the positions where the various countries are.
Absolutely.
Now, let's take a look at what Trump. Now, one of the things I want to point out to people is that when a person comes to power, after he has won the power, what is his immediate thought process? People don't think about that.
Okay.
His immediate thought process is to win the next election.
That's right. Okay.
Right? How does he run his term in a such a way that he will win the next election?
Yes.
Now look at Mr. Trump's situation. He got a minority vote. His victory was right. He got 600,000 votes, 600 million votes less than Hillary.
Right.
One. So his next election is not guaranteed.
So
Second is he won it in the belt, which had old white people who had lost jobs who were feeling the heats of the globalization, right?
Okay.
So Mr. Trump is going to try to assuage that thing, but get more inclusive. Get this percentage of another 5% of voters into his basket.
That's right.
Rather than strengthen his position, right? He wants to win the next election means if he got 49% of the vote and Hillary got 51%, let's say approximation, he wants to make this 49 to 54. So if that comes from Hillary's share, he's built up a 4% lead.
Absolutely.
So think about it from that. So he is going to be inclusive.
Mm.
In trying to get a larger share of the population on his side.
One.
Yes, he is going to do protectionist stance. He is going to repeal the treaty, as you mentioned, the Pacific Treaty.
Pacific, yes.
Right? But that's not necessarily bad. Why? Because look at it from this perspective. A strong America is best for the world.
That's
a strong America which is booming and reviving is the one which will feed the world.
That's right.
Right, world, so the economy of America, because they are a consumption-driven economy, because they are people, when they are optimistic, they go and spend more.
That's right.
So they are actually the lubricant and the vehicle for global growth. So a strong America coming back, yes, certain sectors which are supplying, China which is supplying goods to America,
that's right,
would have cause for worry. India's IT services, they're supplying, yes, it makes H1B tougher,
right,
but our IT services are innovative enough to find ways of doing it in terms of these things. So my point is that when you talk about global recession, actually just because America is becoming protectionist and stronger doesn't mean a global recession. It only means the terms of trade, the way trade gets done.
Okay.
He would be happy to import stuff as long as that is not substituting labor within America. So what America can make, they will make. But what they can't make, they will buy.
They will buy.
And what they can't afford to make, because the American consumer is not a fool to buy a costlier America-made product.
Yes, absolutely.
When there's a cheaper product. End of day. Right?
No, no,
that's the harsh reality. Right? So what they can make, they will make. So what they will try to do. So please let people think a bit.
Yes, yes.
America's high cost of production.
Right.
Right. He will make those goods which people in other countries can buy.
Right. Okay.
Right.
Perfect.
So it's not, so it's America when it gets re-energized, it could be the export industry out of America.
Yeah.
America, there may be certain industries, like he's already talked about shale gas being pumped up.
Yes. Yes.
There are certain industries where America is competitive in production. Shale gas, they are competitive.
Mm.
And where high value-added goods, right, where the high cost of American labor can be justified, he would give tax breaks to them,
that's right,
so that they can be competitive. So America will become again an exporter in the market. So the ramifications of the Trump doctrine or the Trumponomics, right, you will come to see over the next 2 to 3 weeks. But there's no need to panic and say that he is going to strong, healthy, growing America is good for the world. And from an India-specific perspective, remember one thing. India doesn't export so much manufacturing exports to America.
That's right.
So that's not, it's services
only,
is what
it's export. Only the exports.
Second is people worry about our Make in India program, whether Trumponomics will affect it.
That's right.
Right? But Make in India is primarily an import substitution.
Okay.
And not an export oriented one.
That's right. That's right.
Exports will follow import substitution.
Huh.
How? Let me explain very quickly. Let's say we are buying some helicopters for our defense.
True.
Right? That's because that's why he's allowed 100% FDI there. Let's say we need 30 helicopters. So he's going to invite that foreign manufacturer saying, those 30 helicopters I'll buy from you, but please set up a plant in India,
India, yes,
and make 30% local sourcing.
That's right.
Now look at it this way. So that will happen. So first there will be a 30% local sourcing with its own impact on employment and small scale industry. But the second aspect of it, nobody's going to set up a plant just for 30 helicopters in India.
Absolutely.
So he's saying that when you come and make, you look at economies of scale and set up 100 helicopters where he may export that out to other countries.
Other countries.
Right?
No,
so, that, so import substitution will lead to exports in that way.
Right.
Second, who's going to come to India under the liberalized FDI program? Those who not only see Indian wage competitiveness, but those who see India as a market.
Market as well.
So the second thing of Make in India is telling people that, look, India is a huge market. There are products my countrymen need.
Right.
But I want you to come and make them in India. I'm going to give you shops to do that.
Right.
So Make in India has got import substitution. India as a market. And third is the export element.
Export element.
So the Trumponomics impact on Indian manufacturing or Make in India is not going to be as much as now there's a reactive situation to that.
Perfect, perfect. No, I think I agree on that. And for investors who are worried about IT sector,
yes,
the, you know, he said that a lot of scrutiny will take place with respect to immigration and everything. So investors who are worried that IT sector might get hit, what are your thoughts on that?
Okay, two, three things. I think IT sector already was under pressure from Brexit because all of them used London as a base to tackle Europe.
That's right.
We're now revisiting that model to see whether we set up offices in Europe also.
Right.
So that's one thing.
But CEOs have come on various business channels and said that, you know, it will not impact. But, you know, going by what, you know, Trumponomics is going to be, do you think that they're just, you know, displaying a positive picture?
So let me explain again. If you read what Trump has been saying, right? His thing, he's actually praised Indian IT services, okay?
Absolutely.
His problem is about misuse of the H-1B program.
Okay.
Like, if you get a proper work permit to go, see, the H-1B program, if you study it in detail, it is company-specific and not individual-specific.
Okay.
Right? So, what is worried? So, the problem is that, see, there is this IT. So, what he is worried about is that you are coming there and you are shipping a low-cost employee from here to do it there.
Right.
But suppose you are going to manufacture in India and export that service out there to import, and you are not substituting American labor for it, he's not going to worry. So it's a misuse of the H-1B program, you know, where you can do it. That's one thing, right?
Okay.
That's one. Second is his way of tackling this is as he has said already, he's going to hire tax those people who are outsourcing to India.
That's right.
Okay. Right? He's going to put a higher tax. He's going to shut down because he knows that America doesn't have the IT skill set to actually substitute that Indian labor who's doing it.
True.
Right? So all he's going to do is, okay, you are not giving the employment to IT because there is no IT. They're not good enough in that area. At a competitive wage to supply. So you're going to tax them a little bit more for that outsourcing. Right? That's the second thing. Third thing about this IT thing is that the weakening rupee is going to help the IT sector.
IT sector, absolutely.
So you've got to take this also in balance. There's one tailwind of a weakening rupee which is going to help them in terms of their pricing and the contract.
That's right. No, absolutely. There's another very interesting question that we have. I think I'll take a break from the Trumponomics side. Right, and so Pavan Garg, so the gentleman asked, how a retired person should invest to get better returns and also safety of funds. I think mutual fund has time and again proved as a vehicle which can generate, which can make crorepatis. Even a salaried person can become a crorepati. Any advice to the person who is maybe 30 years old, between 30 and 35, started earning, and started earning enough to save? Maybe 20,000-25,000. So how exactly he can structure himself, and then probably when he's retiring, around about 50-60 years of age, he can look at a corpus which is 3 crores, 4 crores or 5 crores. Okay. If he has a saving capacity of, let's say, 20,000-25,000.
Okay. So the first thing here people need to understand is that the future, right, has dramatically altered from his parents' futures.
That's right.
Why am I saying this? Is that the life expectancy has dramatically gone up in India.
Yes, absolutely.
So the post-retirement life is 60-70% of his working life.
That's right. Okay.
Right. So when a person retires, he has got to A, plan for a longer tenure than his
longer
parents
tenure.
Did.
Yes.
Second is that he doesn't know how long he's going to live. Right. So he's got to have that uncertainty element of it also.
That's right.
Factored.
That's right.
Now, they say that there are two things certain in life, right? Death and taxes.
Yes.
But there's a third thing which is certain in a country like India. That's inflation.
Right?
So death, taxes and inflation, you can't run away from.
Absolutely.
Right? Now, the problem with inflation is that you can't predict inflation for a 30-year period. Right? Because you can take the past and say it has been 7%, but there's no guarantee it's going to be 7% forever.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So how does he then create wealth? Right? He has got to tackle this animal or beast called inflation. The only way to ride that beast is to actually ride the tiger.
That's right.
That is, you got to get into an asset class which rises either equal or more than inflation with inflation.
That's right. Okay.
And if inflation is 3, it should be 5. If inflation is 10, it should be 12.
That's right.
Now, what is inflation? Inflation is the rise of price of goods and commodities and services.
Okay.
Right. Now, who's going to hurt from inflation? It is a common man.
That's right.
Who's going to benefit from inflation? From the person who produces the goods, products and services. Who produces goods, products and services? Corporations. Right? So corporations are inherently geared to benefit from rising inflation in their top line.
Right.
And if they are smart in terms of which market they are present, in their bottom line too.
Perfect.
This bottom line is what is financed from either promoter equity or a bank borrowing or from the shareholders. Right?
Yes.
So by buying shares of this company which is going to benefit from inflation is the best hedge a person can have against inflation.
Okay.
That is the case for equities as an asset class.
Perfect. Yeah.
It's naturally geared to grow at or better than inflation because that's what the market prices the P/E ratio at. Right? So now that you've decided that equities is the only asset class over a long term which is going to build that,
right,
the event which you need to manage for, right, then you'll say put 100% money in equities? I would say no.
No.
Why? Because equity markets go through cycles.
Right.
So while over 30 years you can say definitely it will do well, that 30th year may be a year in which India goes to war against Pakistan, there's a Lehman Brothers crisis,
right,
or the demonetization announced, whatever. So that jhatka in that particular year quarter could take away a lot of last 10 years earnings.
That's
so you need to protect yourself against that. So okay. That's where asset allocation comes into the picture.
Right.
So how do you determine the asset allocation? A normal thumb rule, right, is 100 minus a person's age should be in equity. So if he's a 30, 70% of his money should be in equity. One. Second, how do you calculate the returns? There's a rule of 72.
Okay.
Right? 72 divided by the interest rate is a number of years your person's money will double.
Okay. Right.
So 12% is the rate of interest you are getting on something. Right. 72 by 12 is 6. Every 6 years your money will double.
Money.
So when you mention a corpus of 30-35 crores, you look at what is the current FD rates and you see how long it will take double. At current FD rates of 6.5 is the SBI's rate for 3 years now.
Okay.
We will come down to 6 with the demonetization. So 72 by 6 is going to take 12 years to double your wealth if you're going to put it in bank FDs.
Okay.
And if you're taxable, it's going to get even take longer.
Even longer. Yes.
Right. So you've got to balance the two in terms of the investments.
That's right.
Right? Now, when you get closer to retirement, right, automatically readjust this asset allocation. Right. So when you're retiring, let's say 60. You'll have 40% of your assets in equity as per this.
Perfect.
But that equity asset, right, he should then shift. So for people who are already at 55 to 60, so the question on what to do with my retirement money, there what they should look at is there are products. The mutual fund industry has been one of the most innovative in creating products to suit the investors.
Okay.
So there's one, this category which used to be called MIPs. Right, monthly income plans, which used to give monthly interest.
Right.
Those were very good in the days when debt after 1 year was long-term capital gains benefit. A few budgets ago, that became 3 years, and hence a little bit of interest got lost in that. Right, but balanced funds, which have 65% in equity and 35% in debt, have now quickly switched. The industry as a whole, almost all the balanced funds in the industries have moved into a monthly dividend payout program.
Okay.
What is the beauty of this? First of all, your holding after 1 year is tax-free.
That's
if at all you need to liquidate.
Perfect.
Second is that dividend is tax-free.
Okay, that dividend is also
tax-free.
Right.
So even if you're getting a 6% dividend yield, it's equal to 8% bank deposit return.
Okay, perfect. Correct?
Okay?
Because so, bank deposit, you'll have to pay tax.
So balance funds and other regular dividend paying funds. You know, you can look at track records of various funds and see how regularly they pay dividends. There are funds which pay out quarterly dividends. I don't want to make this a marketing exercise of my
funds.
So there are funds in our fund house and in other fund houses.
Right.
Some pay regularly on a quarterly basis.
That's right.
Some pay monthly. Balance funds, by and large, are trying to pay it monthly. So he should shift his money to that because then, you know, post-retirement also his income is taxable, right, from whatever other sources.
Right.
So he should put this on a balanced fund, the equity contribution, so that that monthly dividend keeps coming in as a regular income. And he would still put something in growth because he's still got 25 years to live.
Right.
So there still should be an element of growth built in along with money coming back to him.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And so, in fact, so a minimum monthly balance or monthly a set amount of, let's say, 20,000, 25,000, is it enough? Or should the investor, you know, scale it up a bit as years go by?
You know, he should scale it up a bit because his earning capacity goes up.
Right.
So automatically, he has to have a fixed portion of his income into equities.
Right.
So as his income goes up, he's got to keep readjusting that amount that goes up. One.
Okay.
Second is, what should he expect from equity markets over a long term? Because I just said rule of 72.
That's it.
Right. So if you look at nominal GDP, GDP growth rate plus inflation, what is it today? 7% is our GDP growth. 7.5, but let's take 7 because next 2 quarters will
come down.
7. Inflation is what? 6%. So you're at 13% nominal rate of GDP.
Right.
Every corporate's earnings should grow at normal rate on the top line. Right?
Yes.
Right. The alpha that he generates because he's able to make a profit, right, should be at least 3-4%, right? So I think 15-17% long-term return from the equities asset class is something reasonable. So in order to just do the math, right, to make it easier to divide by 72, let's assume 18%. So 72 by 18 is 4 years.
That's right.
So if every 4 years the money is going to double, right? So you start with, let's say, end of your first cycle of your 25,000 rupees.
That's right.
Let's say you put it for 3 years, right? 25,000 into 12 is 3 lakhs.
That's right.
3 lakhs into 3 is 9 lakhs. Assume some return on that money.
Right.
10 lakhs you have at the end of the first 3 years.
Perfect.
Right? First. That 10 lakhs is going to double every 4 years.
Perfect. Yeah.
Correct. So the end of the 8th year, 7th year, 3 plus 4 is 7. 10 will become 20.
That's right.
At the end of 11th year, 20 will become 40. At the end of the 15th year, 40 will become 80. At the end of the 20th year, 80 will become 1.6 crores. At the end of the 25th year, 1.6 will become 3.2 crores. Right? So 25 years, or no, 30, 55. Another 5 years, 3.2 will become 6.4 crores. So, what's coffee hai?
Both coffee.
And this is only taking that initial corpus of 3 years and multiplying. Whereas SMEs are going to continue. So, I'm
without
saying,
putting any money.
Any money, so 10 to 15, right. 20 crores, people can easily make. Right. If they...
So, if you are a normal salaried guy earning 40, 50,000 or 60,000 maybe, and you can take out at least minimum 15,000 or 20,000 from your monthly income, right? Yes. So you can easily reach the target of crorepati that you've all been waiting for. There's nothing, you don't have to, really go out of place and invest in other products. Just look at mutual funds, and they're more than enough to get you that crorepati tag within a reasonable period of time. By the time you get retired, you have enough money to take care of needs for the rest of your life. So I'll come to next question. Now, this is, there are a lot of conflicting thought points on small and mid-cap stocks. Some say, they have sort of, the decline will continue for them, and the bull run which started probably in 2013 or 2014, maybe, it'll come down a little bit. Well, some say that, the 10-year bull market which started in 2013, or 2014, when Mr. Modi came into the picture, it will resume. So the broader market, so there are conflicting ideas, there are conflicting thought processes. What is your thought process? So some analysts say, okay, small and mid caps is gonna take a hit because a lot of things are gonna take a hit on the economic side. But yes, as you already explained, that it's gonna be for a short term, maybe 2 quarters or 3 quarters. But will that momentum come back from the third quarter onwards? And will the small cap and the broader market will get that kind of, because they're already at, some of them have already doubled with respect to the stock prices. So either they'll see a correction or either probably they will move on from there. What is your thought process?
Okay. So to the doubters and the naysayers, right? They need to take a step back and say, is demonetization going to lead to recession in India?
No.
Okay? Think about it.
Right.
Short term, there is going to be an impact. Undeniably, consumption is going to get hit. Okay? But do you think demonetization is going to lead to recession in India?
Right.
Second is, what is demonetization going to do? You were earlier projecting 7.5 for this year, 8.5 from next year, maybe 10 in 3 years.
Double.
Maybe it's going to push that back a little bit.
Okay.
Maybe the 7.5 this year will actually turn out to be 7.
That's right.
Maybe next year will be only 7.3, 7.4, and the year after.
Okay.
So this is a drastic step which has probably created a pause in the bull market, and it's going to take legs to come out. But what is the Indian economic growth based on? Right? Indian economic growth is based on the infrastructure revival in our country.
That's right.
Consumption is only one leg, the first leg, to kickstart the investment cycle.
That's right.
So the investment cycle is the true multiplier effect in India. That's what is getting postponed a little bit, because unless consumption picks up, today capacity utilization in the country is at 72%. Right? Corporates are not putting in fresh capacity because there's 28% headroom yet before they start getting worried whether I'm going to lose a sale because I don't have a product on the shelf.
True.
Correct? So that process is going to get delayed, but it's not going to run away. It's going to happen.
Right.
One.
Right.
Second is, if you are a believer that India is going to be even able to sustain a 7% growth rate over the next 5 years, assume that all that increase that you want is not happening. Right? In the previous economic cycle, 2003 to 2008, right? India's economic growth rate was around 7-ish percent. Correct?
Yes.
Average. Now, do you know what happened to various cap spectrum then? The Sensex, the large cap index, right, went up 5.5 times.
Okay.
3,000 or to 21,000
almost.
You know that the mid cap index went up 9.5 times.
Okay.
Do you know that the small cap index went up 14 times?
14 times.
Okay. Right. Whereas when the economy went through a down phase, the reverse happened. Large caps were flat because there was QE money still flowing. Mid caps corrected 40%, small caps corrected 60%.
That's right.
The new economic cycle, we are only 3 years into it now.
Okay.
Already, large caps have gone up before this latest correction,
24%. 24%, yes.
Whereas mid caps gone up 90% and the small caps went up 100%.
Right.
So what I'm trying to say is that if you are going to believe that a decent rate of growth is going to be there in the country, small caps are going to outperform mid caps are going to outperform large caps. Okay. And what is the reason for that? The reason for that is, like you mentioned, there are two legs to any stock prices increase.
That's right.
There is a valuation pickup and then there's an earnings play out.
Earnings, definitely.
So the first stage is the valuation pickup. That's what has already happened because stocks have got beaten down in 2013.
That's right.
The first stage of growth is just the valuation pickup. The next stage is the earnings growth stage.
Absolutely.
Right. So
if you're still awaiting.
We are still awaiting. So the point is, the third thing is that when do you buy? Right? What do you do? You buy low,
you
sell
buy
high,
low, sell high.
Right? So if you have a decent confidence that at least a 7% growth rate for the Indian economy is assured, today it's low, no?
It's
because
low.
Of the correction.
Absolutely.
So buy low. You can sell when it's high.
Absolutely.
So there's no need to run away from mid caps and small caps. On the contrary, right? We believe that in all of this demonetization, Trumponomics, and all of these news flows and uncertainties, the only thing which is unchanging is the fact that India is going to add 65 million people to its workforce over the next decade.
Right.
And these kids are already born.
Ah.
Okay.
That's right.
So these are the drivers of our country.
That's right.
These are ones who are going to be cheap labor for everybody.
Yeah.
So you can't wish away this. It's not expecting a Modi master stroke. It is not expecting a Trumponomics. These people are born. They are going to be out there willing to work.
Absolutely.
For wages, and
absolutely.
That's what is going to ultimately make India competitive in terms of manufacturing and taking our country to the next level. So let not people worry. All these people coming up, will if they can't get the salary they currently have, 75% of that salary, he'll say still go and work.
Right.
So I'm just saying economic growth of India is based on the population.
Absolutely.
That has already happened.
That's already happened.
And all the people who are coming to the workforce have already been born and they are there. The issue with the country is to re-energize them with the right skill set to cater to the kind of demands which are going to be there from the world for products made in India.
Okay.
So I think that is unchanged. Nothing is going to wish that away, those people. So I think that employment generation is something that Mr. Modi will have to address.
He's working.
To win. You talked about the 2019 election.
That's right.
That's the big thing you need to address.
Right.
All the rest is up in the air because voting age will become 18.
Right, right.
So these are the people who are now voting with their hands.
With their hands. Absolutely.
Right. So that's his biggest class to which he needs to tackle.
Yeah.
So employment generation is probably the next big thing where we can see over the next 2 years something big happening from the government because that's absolutely critical for him to win the next election. Right. And so on the bedrock of that, I see that Indian economic growth is actually quite self-sustaining because this has a two-wheeler effect. You look at China.
Right.
And you just look at the China statistics of per capita GDP. They reached our current level of GDP, which is $1,500 per capita, way back in 2005.
That's right. Okay.
But you know that from 2005 to 2010, it went from $1,500 to $4,500.
Okay.
So you can imagine what happened if India goes to that same. India just reached where China reached 2005.
In 2005.
So if in the next 5 years we do half of the kind of growth they did, we are going to see 1500 become 2500 per capita GDP, which will generate its own consumption, own thing. So I think there are certain basic facts about India which are unviolable, which can't be wished away.
Which can't be wished away.
So I think people have to go back to that foundation, that pillar, that's your comfort zone, to say that ultimately nobody is going to take away, nobody is going to ship out those people from India and dump them in the Arabian Sea.
Absolutely.
They're there,
absolutely.
They're ready to work. So I think.
So investors, just a closing thought here that Indian economy is on a very strong foot, as Mr. Subramaniam said, and there's no need to get scared of a small correction that happened in the past 7 days, 6 days. Small cap, mid cap stocks are still a very good bet, and you want to create wealth through banking. That's another sector that you can look at.
One point.
Mr. Subramaniam, another
point. I just want to add one point about this correction and all of that. Just go back to 2003-08 cycle, right? That is a bull phase, right? I mentioned Sensex went up 5.5 times and other indices went up. Can you believe that there were 8 corrections ranging from 10 days to 50 days and ranging from a corrections of 5% up to 26% in the middle of that bull wave?
Okay.
So And there's another strategy which says that if you miss the 40 best days of the year, you would only got state bank deposit return from the stock market. Right? It's only those who stayed invested through those corrections who made all the gains. So corrections are a natural part of a bull market, and they are the time when smart investors stay invested or go and buy additional things.
That's right.
At that time. So I think that something at one point I wanted to reiterate to the audience.
Absolutely. So another thing I'll quickly add to what Mr. Subramaniam said, and a very good point, that these events, we could call them black swan events, as you mentioned in one of our interviews with Etina. Okay. That's right. So these black swan events are the key to wealth creation, and not just for and wealth creation not just in for a year, but over a period of time. If you buy stocks right now, if you buy sectors, stocks which are at billion on prices, valuations are good management profile. If you buy those stocks at current valuation, at current levels, they will indeed give you the sort of return that you've all been waiting for over the period of time. And there's no need to hesitate about the recent correction that we just saw in the past 6 and 7 days. Please, that's perfectly all right. It's all part of the bull market. And India is still in a bull market. And there's a lot of, it's not the end of the story for India. The economics are strong, macros are strong. Rupee might appreciate a little bit, but that's nothing to worry about. IT stocks are great. There might be a blip, but that will give you an opportunity to buy. And small and mid-cap story stays intact. And with that note, I think I will thank Mr. Subramaniam for being part of this show. And wish you a very,
Do you have time for one more interpretation, or you will take?
No, absolutely, please.
I just wanted to leave a small mathematical equation with the investors to understand why mid-cap stocks do much better than large-cap stocks economy, good growth phase.
That's right.
Okay? So this is a very simple math which they should keep in their mind.
Okay.
The differentiator between a mid-cap company and a large-cap company is the fact that fixed costs are very high for mid-cap companies, both because of their investment is higher and because they have less equity to put, so they borrow much more.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. These fixed costs are called operating leverage and financial leverage in jargon. So leave that aside.
That's
so let's take a company. It has 10 rupees as top line sales. Okay? And typically a mid-cap company would have 40% as its fixed cost, let's say. So 4 rupees as a cost. And let's say the total cost structure is 6 rupees.
Okay.
So the company is making 4 rupees profit,
right.
10 minus 6. Right? Now, in an economic downturn, what happens is that, let's say there's a 20% correction in the sales. Because the economy is going down. So 10 becomes 8. Right? But the 4 remains 4. And let's assume that the other 2 also goes down to 1.6. Same 20% and the other variable costs go down. So it's 10 has become 8. His total cost structure is now 5.6. So his profit is 2.4. So from a profit of 4 rupees, his profit came down to 2.4. So 1.6 over 4 rupees is a 40% drop. So a 20% drop in sales led to a 40% drop in profits. So when economic downturn happens, they get rogered and they get hit. Now just take the other scenario. 10, 6, 4. Those are the three costs. 4 fixed costs, 6 is overall cost including the fixed cost, 10. Let's say there's a 20% increase in top line. 10 becomes 12. So let's say 2 also grows at 20%. So 2 becomes 2.4.
Four
remains 4.
Remains
so his total cost goes to 6.4. So 12 minus 6.4 is his new profit.
That's right.
Which is how much? See, 3.6, 10 minus 6, plus 2.
Plus 2.
So 5 points.
5 points.
What is his profit earlier? 4. 1.6 increase. 40%
increase
in profits. For a 20% increase in
sales.
Right. This simple example people should keep in their mind.
Right.
Because once they think about the economy and say, is Indian economy going to go decently grow? Then a mid-cap company with that small increase in sales is going to show much greater increase
much
in profits and EPS. And then the market recognizes that as a higher PE.
Right.
It was growth possible record and then revalues that stock.
Right.
So this is a simple funda. They have to keep in mind.
Right.
So look at the economy. Do you think long-term economy is going to do well? Put more of your money in mid-cap and small-cap.
Absolutely.
That's the way I just want it.